Dobro večer. Velika mi je čast i iznimno veliko zadovoljstvo da mogu predstaviti u našem cijenjenom društvu ovdje profesora sa Birbeck instituta za humanističke znanosti, to jest profesora na Birbeck koleđu koji je profesor prava i teorije prava i ovo je iznimno, ovaj povod je vrlo izniman zato što je izašla njegova knjiga Filozofija i otpor u krizi koja je nastala gotovo za mjesec dana kada je bio u Grčkoj bez popratne literature, nego puno gnjeva i puno zanimljivih observacija u kojoj je pokušao spojiti na vrlo originalan način teoriju i praksu. Profesor Douzinas je napisao nekoliko vrlo važnih knjiga, pogotovo koja se tiču ljudskih prava, uredio je Cambridge Companion za koja se tiče ljudskih prava, također je uredio knjigu sa Slavojem Žižekom o ideji komunizma, gdje ima odličan članak o nepravdi. S nama je danas ovdje, imat će predavanje, promislite o dobrim pitanjima. Žao nam je što neki od vas jučer nisu bili kada smo predstavljali cijelu ovu njegovu prekrasnu knjigu, koja je bila dobar uvod u ono što će on danas govoriti. Puno vam hvala još jedan put i sa toplim aplauzom pozdravimo profesora Costasa Douzinasa.
Thanks very much, Boris, and I would like to thank, before I start, the Subversive Forum and Festival, the people who have created the most interesting forum and festival in Eastern Europe and perhaps the whole of Europe. You know, it has given us loads of ideas about things to do in Western Europe. So thank you, Sreczko, Igor, Yelena, and all the others. It has been a wonderful few days. And of course, I'm here as the warm-up act. I'm here as the band who has the gig before the big band, before the Rolling Stones. So Tsipras and Zizek is between Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. You have to decide who is who. On June 17, 2011, close to the mic. Thank you. I will have also at some point to start making some obscene gestures to the booth upstairs because I have a few pictures to show it to you. Okay. And apparently there is no remote control. Okay. On June 17, 2011, I was invited to address the Syntagma Square occupation in a thematic debate on direct democracy. After the four speakers, as it was usual in Athens and in these occupations, people started queuing to address the occupation after the main addresses. Lots were drawn, and people with their numbers drawn were queuing in a line to come up and speak. And there was a man in that audience who was absolutely shaking and trembling with nerves. It was quite clear that he had no experience of addressing the public, certainly not the 15, 20,000 people who were in Syntagma Square that day. And I was really getting worried about him. And then he gets to the top of the queue, he gets a microphone, and starts giving an absolutely word-perfect address. For the 3 or 4 minutes he had at his disposal, he gives a brilliant, beautiful talk about the future of the movement. It is rhetorically well constructed in sentences and paragraphs. It was absolutely superb. When he stops, I go up to him and said, "My friend, how come that you spoke so beautifully? I thought you were going to collapse as you were waiting for your turn." And the guy turns around to me and says, "That is exactly what I was also fearing." And then when I got in front of the mic, a stranger in me started dictating what I had to say. This stranger was speaking, I was just mouthing the words. Many participants in the recent occupations and other protests and revolts make similar statements. Sarah, an Egyptian, tells her mother after spending time in Tahrir Square, "I am not myself, I am somebody new that was born today." My talk is precisely an attempt to understand how the stranger in me of course, a standard way of describing the unconscious in psychoanalysis. How this miraculous transubstantiation of people takes place. What can philosophy, political philosophy, tell us about the recent spate of resistances, revolts, insurrections, and riots? And what can we learn out of these events in order to pursue further resistances and uprisings? Now, of course, as we know, the end of history and the dawn of a new world order was announced in 1989. If it was a new order, it was rather short, perhaps the shortest in history. The banking collapse of 2008, followed by the Euro crisis and the world economic crisis in 2010, meant that it has come to an end. Protests, riots, and uprisings all over the world have broken out, but neither mainstream political science nor radical philosophy were either able to predict or indeed to fully understand the events. A former director of Britain's secret intelligence service thought that, I quote, it is a revolutionary wave, like 1848. The English commentator Paul Mason agrees. There are strong parallels, he says, above all with 1848 and with a wave of discontent that preceded 1914. Alain Badiou, in his post-Arab Spring book, Le Réveil de l'Histoire, Awakening of History, translated into English as The Rebirth of History, diagnoses that we live in an age of emeut, translated into English as riots and uprisings. And this emeut takes place in an interval between two periods of revolutionary upheaval. However, Badiou's left melancholy carries the day, and his conclusion is that precisely we don't live in a rebirth of history. The three times of emeut that he presents, immediate, latent, and historic, historic being the Arab Spring, have not adopted his idea of communism, and therefore they cannot really start the new process, a new age of revolutionary upheaval. And unfortunately, my friend Slavoj Žižek, following Badiou, seems to agree with that, because of course his post Arab Spring book is called The Year of Dreaming Dangerously, not Living Dangerously. Still, as far as I'm concerned, and I think all of us know here in the Balkans, Slovenia, Bulgaria, Romania, Kosovo, riots, resistance, revolt is in the air. Are the spies or the radical philosophers right? And obviously the spies are right. My claim today is that that radical philosophy has failed to explain and understand what is happening in the world. Obviously, it remains the best resource we have in order to both draw lessons and then move forward, but that in order to do that, we have precisely to observe what new has been happening over the last 4 years all over the world, get lessons out of that, and then perhaps put them to some practical use. Now, what could we say caused this return of the repressed, of resistance, of riots, of uprisings, after this long interval, according to Badiou, between revolutionary periods, after these 40 years of political apathy and passivity of the citizens all over the world, but of course even here in Europe, in democratic countries. Let me remind you that both the Jewish and the Greek tradition, both theology and philosophy, in their foundational mythologies, start with an act of disobedience. The original sin in the Garden of Eden and Prometheus' theft of fire from the gods of Olympus, two acts of theft, of disobedience, of rebellion, have founded the Western civilization. Solo, the first legislator of Athens, legendary legislator of Athens, writes in his laws the following, one of his great commandments. Whoever, when civil strife prevails, does not join forces with either party, one or the other party, is to be disenfranchised and not to be a member of the city. In other words, if we look at our Western tradition, and of course, all the way to today, as Etienne Baliba puts it, democracy, speaking of course about contemporary world, democracy survives because it has an integral insurrectionary moment. Citizenship is paradoxical. It is conflictual or nothing. Now, as I'm sure you know, Michel Foucault, throughout his life, has created what one could call an analytics of power. My meager attempt, following on from Foucault's work, is to create an analytics of resistance, a philosophical attempt to understand what is the essential character of resistance, of resistances, and then through that to also help build political praxis. So let me start with three axioms, you could call it, three theses on the meaning, or the essence rather, of resistance, which I will then build upon with the experience of the last few years in order to come to a more complete image. First, resistance is a law of being, internal and immanent to its object. From the moment being takes form, or a force or a balance of forces gets stabilized, resistance immediately emerges and irresistibly twists, fissures being or the balance of forces. In a relationship, in a family, in a business, in a school class, obviously in bigger organizations, in a party, in a state, there is always resistance. Whenever you have power, you have resistance. It is integral, imminent to all being. Two, resistances are always situated. They are local and multiple. They emerge concretely in specific conditions, responding to a situation, a state of affairs, an event. Three, resistance is a mixture of reaction and action, negation and affirmation. Reactive resistances conserve and restore a state of things. Active resistances borrow, mimic, subvert the adversary's arms and invent new rules, new institutions, new relations. Let me explore now these initial three theses that come directly out of the work of Michel Foucault and François Proust, one of Foucault's followers, by examining and exploring them using examples from Greece, which is the most advanced and successful Western case of resistance. Now, of course, I'm not using Greece, either because I'm a Greek or because I think that Greece has a particular place in God's book of elect nations and all good things come from Greece. No, Greece was adopted or was chosen by European and Greek elites to be turned into a guinea pig for a rearrangement of late capitalism. And because it was the first choice, obviously resistances started there and using historical experience and examples grew over the years. Now, forms, subjects, and strategies of resistance, as I said, emerge within circuits of power, reacting and rearranging its operations. To explain their multiplication, recent multiplication, their forms, as I say, strategies and subjects, we must start, therefore, from an exploration of the state we're in. Now, a basic claim that I'm making against the economic orthodoxy and heterodoxy is that the greatest catastrophe threatening Greece and the Europe of austerity is not economic. The greatest catastrophe threatening our nations is the total destruction of the social bond, the total destruction of the way in which we understand, we see ourselves, we relate to others, we relate to the social, to the community. That is the greatest catastrophe because this is long term. Economic problems, economic crisis, austerity and all the rest of it, fiscal deficits can be in the medium term restored. Once you lose the social ethos, which is the cement around which our nations are being built, much stronger than perhaps Northern Europe, then it seems to me there is no way back, or way, you know, coming back, it would be much harder. So I have to start from the state we're in, and abandoning some of the banalities of the economists about euro and drachma and so on. And of course, Yanis is one of the Varoufakis, one of the people who, in a sense, goes against those banalities. Let me put it from a different perspective that looks into economy and economics in a much wider social and cultural setting. Now, it was Marx first who introduced the concept of the general intellect and immaterial labor, the work and products of the collective mind, science, and technology. In post-industrial capitalism, this type of immaterial production has become the most important productive force. Industrial capitalism turned the concrete into abstract, the product into commodity. Post-industrial capitalism turns thoughts, ideas, and words immediately into material objects and products. The general intellect is no longer incorporated in machinery as dead labor and capital, but in the lives of working people. Three consequences follow from that. The progressive immaterialization of production, coupled with globalization, means that particularly for people below 40 years of age, permanent work has been abolished, or it is on the way of being abolished. Part-time, flexible, piecework, long periods of unemployment following short periods of work are now the rule. We must be flexible, adjustable, willing to learn, continuously improve on our skills, on our knowledge and our aptitudes. Secondly, profit now takes two major new forms. I mean, they're not necessarily new, but they're becoming now central. Rent for services and interest for capital. Wages get pushed down brutally in order to improve profits, and unemployment is no longer a way of having a reserve army that pushes wages down. Unemployment has become a structural characteristic of late capitalism, which means that millions of people have become superfluous, redundant, useless. They are the unemployed and unemployable, the young and the old, the immigrants and the refugees. This has created an increasingly volatile political situation, as large numbers of people have no inherent stake in the continuation of the socio-political system. The huge increase in police repression and security measures, something that our governments usually blame on the fear of terrorism, is in reality the near permanent state of exception that preempts, it is a preemptive response to the permanent state of political turmoil that the situation I was describing has created. The third change is the extensive and violent privatization of the commons, the three commons of social life, social services and culture, of external nature, and even of our own biological life are systematically sold off. We must rent back from capital our common substance, our collective achievements. Everything that can be sold will be sold and then had back to us. All this means that late capitalism increasingly works through consumption funded, fueled by debt and interest. People, companies, and states are treated as consumers who must borrow to spend. Debt has become integral to life. student loans and loans for personal consumption, enterprise loans and mortgages. These make the larger part of the population permanently indebted. The same, of course, applies to companies and states. Debt is not the great enemy many present, but it is the indispensable lubricant in the economy of services for which consumption is the main avenue for growth. Following the work of Maurizio Lazzarato, who was speaking here yesterday, I would add that debt is a social relation and moral concept before being an economic relationship. The creditor controls the debtor's conduct much more than the employer does the employee. The debtor is infused with moral guilt, existential forbearance. She is formally free, but only if she accepts a life of redemption and repayment. In this sense, debt preempts radical change by ensuring the obedient conduct of the debtor. Our current predicament is not, I would say, a debt crisis, but the ruling elite's desire of debt. Indeed, Greece is a textbook case of debt's desire, this lovely double genitive. The desire of debt, who desires debt, what does the debt desire? After entry to the euro, the modernizing socialists promoted consumption and hedonism as the main way of linking private interests and the common good. People were treated as desiring and consuming machines, easy and cheap loans, bribing people to transfer their savings into stocks and shares, artificial increase of real estate values. All these became the main instruments of economic growth, and the criterion of linking personal happiness and social mobility with economic results. Of course, the aim of that was the beginning of a breakdown of communities, the atomization of the population, the creation of a popular capitalism where even the poorest would feel they have a stake in the capitalist system. The privatization of social services would supposedly lead to free choice and personal responsibility. The obscene father of psychoanalysis kept telling the Greek population, enjoy, buy, live as if this is your last day. And as we know from psychoanalysis, this consumer paradise of desire, satisfaction, frustration is the purest form of value nihilism. Austerity violently reversed these priorities in order to achieve the same objective. The objective of controlling populations through indebtedness and guilt. The population was now divided according to age, occupation, gender, and race, and of course, nationality, and radical behavioral change is now imposed for the sake of national salvation. The politics of personal desire and pleasure turned into a strategy of saving the nation. Indeed, almost literally, its genetic information, its DNA, those biological and health metaphors are full in the discourse. The discourse of the authorities, of the austerity authorities, are full, are replete of this type of metaphors. Punitive austerity completes the project by now turning aggressive into defensive nominalism or individualism. There is only individuals and the sovereign. The riot police, the criminal courts, the prisons are now called in to enforce a near permanent state of exception. Now the stakes behind the desire of debt as consumption or austerity, the stakes behind it is a top-down rearrangement of late capitalism. Austerity has been used to reduce workers' salaries, rights, and benefits, while at the same time ensuring capital profitability. Wages will meet those of the Chinese at some point, and so will labor and social conditions. The European and Greek elites seem to have decided on these reforms. The debt and deficit offered a convenient pretext for their fast and brutal imposition and their moralization. We all sinned together, and we must be punished. Mrs. Merkel was acting and still acting like Michael Haneke's white ribbon pastor, or indeed like Freud's superego. They keep punishing in a sadistic way their victim, and they punish the victim more the more the victim obeys their commands. Successive Greek governments have been asking Mrs. Merkel, what do you want, Mrs. Merkel? And Mrs. Merkel, on some occasions, says, we want you in the euro. In others, we don't want you in the euro. In other cases, we don't. I just don't know. And of course, that reminds us very well the Freudian question, what does the woman want? What does Mrs. Merkel want? And as we know from our Freud, there is never any answer to that question, because the woman herself does not know. But it is precisely the posing of the question. It is precisely the lack of answer and continuous repetition of the question and the anxiety that it creates that keeps desire going. This is precisely what has happened with the Greek elites. They keep asking Mrs. Merkel what she wants. Mrs. Merkel gives ambiguous answers or no answers, so they keep trying to improve their efforts to please the lady. So this was the situation, as I see it, against which resistances started happening in Greece at a period where they were happening all over the world. Let me repeat again that I will use Greek examples, both because I know them, but because I think that they're absolutely typical of what new is happening in this in resistances all over the world. Now, resistances emerge as reactions to this circuit of desire, satisfaction, frustration, which characterized the previous period of fake growth, and the reverse sequence which characterizes today, which is punishment, recognition of guilt and repentance, and finally, obedience, acceptance of your position. As they react to this neoliberal and biopolitical control of behavior, powers, conduct of the conduct of people, they all involve change in behavior, not ideas. They involve a certain rearrangement of conduct, perhaps later change in ideology, but I don't think that that is terribly important. Now, of course, throughout the last 4 years, 5 years, you had all type of resistances, strikes, rallies, demonstrations, the usual stuff organized by unions, by parties, the usual stuff that we know very well in the history of the European social and labor and political movements. However, what characterizes our age as the new age of insurrections and revolts are three new forms of resistance, all of which were very central in Athens. Now, this is supposed to show something. Okay. Athens, December 2008. Within hours of the unprovoked police killing of the 15-year-old Alexis Grigoropoulos in downtown Athens, a massive insurrection by young people broke out in Athens and all over Greece. Some 800 secondary schools were occupied. Daily marches to police stations, parliaments and ministries were accompanied by a number of highly imaginative protests. Sit-ins, street happenings, here the occupation of state TV during the main news bulletin, interruption of theater performances in discussion with the audience, the raising of a banner in the Acropolis calling people to resistance. Of course, there was also scuffles with the police and some damage to cars and property, mainly luxury shops. However, no deaths were reported. For 2 weeks, central Athens was occupied by these young people who had total control of the situation, and eventually the whole thing came to an end after the during the Christmas break. This is the violence. It was sporadic, quite extensive in certain parts of the city, but as I said, with no major casualties. This was the Communist Party banner, and of course, the most iconic aspect of these events was the burning of the Christmas tree in precisely Syntagma Square. And it became iconic throughout the world with a postcard, Merry Christmas from Athens. No party led the insurrection. No specific demands were put forward. Nobody in any sense tried to claim that as an ideology, as a party, as a position, was the leading force in these events. Second, Athens, February 2011. While the Maghreb Revolution was taking place in North Africa, 300 undocumented sans-papier immigrants from North Africa took refuge in central Athens building called Hepatia and staged a hunger strike. They had lived and worked in Greece for up to 10 years, doing the jobs the Greeks did not want to do for a fraction of the minimum wage without social security. When the crisis struck, they were unceremoniously kicked out. After 40 days in the building, eventually, when a number of them were close to death as a result of irreversible damage to vital organs, the government, an austerity government, of course, finally accepted the bulk of their demands. The third type of resistance. On May 25, a multitude of men and women of all ideologies, ages, occupations, including the many unemployed and immigrants, calling themselves the Agonaktis Meni, the indignant, started occupying Syntagma Square, Constitution Square in Athens, opposite Parliament, and some 60 other squares in cities and towns. The occupations in Spain and Greece were inspired by Tahrir Square, and in turn inspired the worldwide Occupy movement. Political parties and banners were discouraged. No leaders and spokespersons emerged. The occupations were peaceful, but faced huge police attacks that were called by the Athens Bar and the Athens Medical Association war crimes. It was totally peaceful. It had a number of activities, including cultural events, a number of groups, the medical group, the lawyers group, the food group, the media group were organized and worked using direct democratic methods. And of course, a number of major international artistic groups and troops came to Athens. This is the Le Théâtre du Soleil of Ariane Newskin, which staged a specially devised event in Syntagma supporting the occupiers. The then Papandreou government resigned twice. First on June 15, a couple of days before I got to Athens, and then of course finally in early November, soon after people occupied the street where a military parade was about to take place and the president had to flee. And of course, in the two elections of 2012, this multitude became a people, became a population, and voted massively for Syriza, the radical left coalition. To that extent, Greek resistance, as I put it, has led to a half victory. So we have so far, in this age of revolts and resistances, 2.5 victories. Egypt, Tunisia, the half is Greece, remains to be completed. So these are the three new forms of resistance that have become, as I'm sure you know, quite persistent and have been repeated all over the world. Let me now then move from forms of resistance to subjects of resistance. What causes this behavior change? The direct integration of the working people into the economy of debt is at the same time the Achilles heel of biopolitical capitalism. The worker can withdraw abruptly and violently if one of the links in the chain of the integration chain breaks. This can happen through the sudden loss of job, major deterioration in conditions of life or expectations, frustration of desires or promises. This is precisely what the sequence, December, the riots, Hepatia, the hunger strike, and Syntagma achieved. This is how the stranger in me emerged, this metamorphosis of subjectivity. It disarticulates subjects from the circuit of desire, consumption, frustration, and helps the emergence of disobedient subjects. The refusal to obey law or policies, the invention of new types of street action, turned disobedience into a political baptism. This baptism releases the subject from the consolations of normality and the numbing of normalization, and the technologies of self that power uses in order to control our behavior and conduct turn into a care for self, a radical behavioral change. So in what we just examined, three new forms of subjectivity emerged, which match the three main forms of exclusion and subjection in late biopolitical capitalism. First, we have the expendable, redundant humans. Second, those who are biopolitically excluded. Third, those who are democratically disenfranchised. First, the inhuman, those who are excluded from humanity, the sans-papier undocumented immigrants. In a world where life exists as registered life, undocumented life is not recognized at all. Minimum humanity is created through what the immigrants lacked: papier, documents, files. To retrieve their life from this administrative void, they had to come to the threshold of death. The sans-papier, in that sense, became martyrs, which in Greek, of course, means both witnesses and sacrificial victims. They confirmed something that, from Rousseau to Freud, Western philosophy knows quite well. Man is free to die of freedom. Life is worth living if it is worth dying for. In that sense, when these people, for 40 days, stayed in this place in Athens, staged in a hunger strike and bringing them to the threshold of death, these were the only free people of Athens. The December insurrection now of the supposedly apolitical youths was precisely a reaction to the combination of frustration and its companion, police repression. The insurgents were people whose interests are never heard. They exist socially, but not politically. And they must perform their existence through the absolute negation of what exists. They did not demand anything specific. This is true. They simply said, enough is enough. Here we stand against. Not I claim this or that right, but I claim the right to have rights. This is politics, of course, at degree zero, the first but insufficient step in the emergence of political subjectivity. Caught between the demands of an insatiable desire and brutal repression, they performed the absolute freedom of acting out. When negation and affirmation, reaction and action cannot be synthesized, they remain opposed. Violence is the link between the two forces. Now, my friend Alain Badiou and Slavoj Žižek dismissed these events. Admittedly, they didn't speak about Athens. Badiou spoke about the riots in the Paris banlieue in 2005 and 2007, and Žižek about those in London in 2011. I think they were both wrong. The stake of these repeated events was not, and is not, of course, the immediate overthrow of government, let alone of capitalism, as Badiou seemed to expect. The question was preliminary, and is preliminary to that. It is about the disarticulation of subjectivities from what I call the pleasure principle, the insatiable and failing pursuit of happiness, nihilism at its extreme. To that extent, December was late capitalism in a rebellion, to use a Hegelian term, the rebellion of the poor, a process of production and construction of subjects of resistance. Now, having said a few things now about these forms and subjectivities, the construction of new subjectivities, let me give you a fourth and fifth thesis that it seems to me emerges out of this analysis. Number four, resistance is a process or experience of creation of new subjects. We become subjects, the stranger in me emerges with the realization of a split in my identity. I pass over to the side of the universal because my particularity has failed, because my identity is internal, fissured, incomplete, lacking. When I see my unemployment, the attack on my gender or sexuality, the denial of basic humanity that I receive, not as my own failure, but as a symptom of the wider socio-political order, then the switch from subjected person to subject starts taking place. Thesis number five. Resistance does not apply simply values and principles and does not have a predictable point of condensation and explosion. It is not the idea of justice or equality or communism or the party or whatever that leads to resistance. But it is precisely the sense of injustice, the hurt to bodies, the hunger, the despair, the physical material feeling, I can't take it anymore. The idea of justice or equality or communism survives as a result of resistances, and it is not what leads to resistances. To that extent, resistance and resistance subjects prepare the collective we when you are going to get a condensation of different events and an assemblage of subjectivities. Only when different forms and resistances converge, when people in different places, in different regions and sectors say, in relation to their own specific situation, enough is enough, only at that point, when they become prepared to act on this enough is enough, radical change can take place. In this sense, the first syntagma resolution, which pronounced that we are not leaving the squares before government, troika, banks, memoranda, and those who exploit us are left, was precisely a condensation of causes, an assemblage of subjectivities that created what I would call a constitutional performative. In that we, and this we, as of course Chantal Mouffe has clearly explained over the years, that we can only be created against a they which was the troika, the government, international capital, and so on. In that we and they, you create a fault line within the social world, what one could call a constituent counter power. The we of the people and the they of the enemy were created temporarily, perhaps, in that act. At that point, the syntagma multitude spoke for the whole population. Syntagma was the whole of Greece. It both mimicked and subverted the principles of representation and state organization. As I said, an elaborate network of working groups offered a microcosm of a future democratic state operating under a strict axiom of equality. Syntagma was not a suffering and victimized population. It was an active people who performed radical democracy and prefigured the necessary institutional and constitutional changes. Now, Greek resistances and these new types and forms of resistance confirmed aspects of radical philosophy, but also corrected it and moved the theory forward. The mainstream media had called the December youth, the rioting December youth, a rabu, a mob. In Syntagma, the mob became a multitude. In the electoral polls, in the election booths, it became a people. Now, of course, the reference to the rabu reminds us of two major divides in social and political theory. Social psychology, from Le Bon to Freud and MacDonald, has approached the crowd as a threatening, irrational, feminine, and emotional beast. It libidinally invests, says Le Bon, and indeed Freud, in the leader or some totalitarian idea and hacks back to the non-civilized part of humanity. Mainstream political philosophy, similarly, presents power as unified, the sovereign and its foil, a homogeneous people or a nation. This is the origins of the one. For Machiavelli, Spinoza, or Toni Negri, on the other hand, the basic political category is the multitude, a multiplicity of singularities which acts collectively but does not become a single body, a common entity. Indeed, for Negri, the multitude replaces social class. It is both the creation of empire's unification of the social space and its potential nemesis. Syntagma brought together and transcended those bipolar and antagonistic approaches. Of course, in material production, the general intellect as a main force of life promotes networking, but not political cooperation. Communication, but not ideological identities. Collaboration based on atomization and self-interest. In Syntagma, the precarious workers, the unemployed, the self-employed, even the middle class, put into political practice the networking and collaboration skills we have to learn for our own job on a daily basis. Over 60% of European youth have now post-secondary education, and exactly the same skills as their rulers. This is a first in human history, that we, hoi polloi, and our rulers, the bankers or the politicians, have exactly the same skills. But of course, in a situation of youth unemployment, of a total annihilation of a whole generation, what one could call a genocide. Of course, if it was a genocide, immediately the human rights NGOs would start campaigning. But this genocide, the killing of a generation, does not seem to involve our human rights so much. But of course, 1,000 unemployed lawyers, engineers, and doctors can be more revolutionary than 1,000 unemployed workers. And this is precisely where we stand. The Syntagma multitude, unlike Negri, was not an abstract social category, but a material coming together of people in public with a common political desire. The radical change of the political system was their aim. But again, unlike the crowd of Le Bon and Freud, it was not a mute, but a speaking, acting crowd. It did not have representatives and leaders, but its own democratic action. Indeed, for Aristotle, the demos of democracy, is the multitude in assembly. Now, the theory of multitude of Hard and Negri gives useful analytical tools, but only a multitude in assembly, the people as demos, can initiate radical change. The multitude is the social foundation. The demos is the political subject. Two strategies emerged and coalesced in those amazing days. A narrow strategy of conflict, a wider or hegemonic intervention. And these are the two strategies that are important for us today, not just in Greece, but all over Southern Europe and the Balkans. To use an expression that will put a smile in many a Marxist or cynical lip, the end of the power system in Greece and further afield in the South is now a matter of historical necessity. And here I'm speaking about the philosophy of history, so I don't want people jumping up and saying, when do you expect it to happen? Revolutions take place and succeed when a political power system has run its course and has become obsolete and harmful. And this is the case in Greece and Southern Europe. Of course, as we know, historical necessity can only be interpreted retrospectively. What appears now as a contingent or random event from the position of the future will appear, will become one link in a sequence of events that leads inexorably to the end product. Now, three elements are required to turn in this retrospective way contingency into necessity. A strong popular desire, a political agent prepared to take power, finally a catalyst which combines the other elements into a combustible whole. All three elements appear to exist at this point in Greece, not all three in other Southern European countries, but certainly in Greece. We have popular will that was expressed in all these resistances and then was condensed, congealed, created subjects of resistance, people who had nothing to do with the left, with the trade unions, with marches and parties and demonstrations. Secondly, we have a series as the political agent, and I'm sure you will be able to interrogate Alexis Tsipras later. And then, of course, austerity, the memorandum, as a symbolic condensation of austerity policies, of neoliberal and biopolitical capitalism, became the catalyst that I think will certainly lead to the collapse of the current power system. Whether it will lead to the first radical left government in Europe, that remains to be seen. Is the left ready for that? And this is a question that people always ask. I think Yanis talked about it yesterday. In life, there are acts that you prepare for and others that hit you on the head, like a miracle, like an earthquake. You are never ready to fall in love or to start a revolution. We plan our major steps in life. We balance the pros and the cons. We think about this, that, and the other. But of course, if we continue balancing all the time, we never act. The decision, the act, is a little like madness. It's a coup de foudre. It's a hit on the head. Something unexpected. It takes over, and this is what happened to Syriza. It has been taken over. It has been adopted by the people, not necessarily because it did great and wonderful things between 2008 and 2012, but it was hit on the head, and the only thing it can do now is to take power if, of course, the philosophy of history turns out to be right, which is not always the case. To this extent, the question that Zizek keeps asking, I'm sure he will ask it again tonight, what will the left do once in power, has one and only answer. The day after will be exactly the same as the day before. It will be a continuation of what happens now. In other words, what Syriza does now, what the left in Europe does now, prepares precisely what it will be doing if and when it is in power. And that is why what is happening now all over Europe is so important. There is no blueprint, there is no precedent. The left will have to improvise and adjust to become brutally pragmatic and uncompromisingly principled. Now, of course, the economists and the sociologists and the social policy makers can say many things about the kinds of policies that the left should develop and, a possible left government adopt. What I want to say here briefly and finish is this. The resistance subjectivities, in particular syntagma, and that kind of dynamism, of energy, of huge drive to resist, I think these have created an institutional and cultural memory and are the most important resources, not just for Greece, but for the whole of the South and the Balkans. So first, the social composition of post-Fordist capitalism means that the age of leaders, centralized parties and unions, solid and conscious political subjects, awaiting representation, all that is on the way out. Cooperation and networking, solidarity and horizontal organization, sharing of knowledge and skills should be and are the guiding principles. The squares transferred these principles from work to politics, reversing the hierarchy, the disciplining, the control and autocratic management of capitalism. We are the squares where everywhere is and should be the guiding principle, extending those ideas to economic, social, and cultural life. Initiatives from below, direct democratic initiatives, physical and virtual collaboration, bringing people and skills together would revive the faltering sense of community that we're observing. That collapse of social ethos that I mentioned at the beginning, which is, let me repeat, much more threatening the future of any nation than any economic crisis and fiscal deficit or debt. Second, and following again from the experience of the resistances, the left has to develop everywhere hegemonic politics. The continuous recreation of a we the people, a popular poll that identifies, the political party has to identify at every point in time, because it may have to change, a central fault line that will split the social body in a us and them. And speaking here and following the Balkan Forum, it is absolutely clear that what is happening in Bulgaria and Romania and Slovenia, in Kosovo, gives to our Balkan friends precisely similar opportunities, similar occasions to act upon. But you have to follow that hegemonic idea. Perhaps corruption, perhaps the defense of social services, of health, can become the fault line, the central way of splitting the social body and turning us into an us, a we, against the they, the them, the enemy. An unemployed right-wing person and an unemployed left-wing person suffer exactly the same. A poor nationalist and a poor internationalist suffer exactly the same. The left, particularly in creating and promoting hegemonic projects, cannot afford to abandon any part of the social body to the right wing or to fascists. And this is what hegemonic policy does. Realizes at each point in time what fault line would unite, even temporarily, the larger part of the population, being aware, of course, that that part of the population is driven by internal conflicts and families, between private and public sector workers, between the employed and the unemployed, between those better paid and those worse paid. But if you find a fault line, say, anti-corruption, or defense of the health system, defense of the educational system, a fault line that makes people understand that that particular interest is much more important than their own sectional divides and concerns. This is exactly what happened in those occupations and resistances. This is the great message that we have to carry through both in the South and in the Balkans. But of course, that idea of hegemony, that idea of speaking for the common interest of the whole population, must be accompanied, completed, complemented by a politics of conflict. This is the politics that places at the center of the attention of the left those people and groups and interests which are totally excluded from our society. So the unemployed youth, the immigrants, those people who are either totally biopolitically invisible or who are almost non-human, these are the people who, to my mind, represent the principle of universalism. In a society that keeps talking about equality and freedom while at the same time delivering the greatest structural inequality in the whole of human history, the principle of universality is represented by those totally excluded. So a combination of hegemonic policies, of fault lines, perhaps even moving fault lines, that try at each point in time to capture the idea of the common interest of the common good and to neutralize or bracket, even temporarily, sectional divisions and conflicts. And on the other hand, social mobilization, the preparedness to go all the way in supporting those groups that today, in a sense, are what for Marx the proletariat was. Those groups whose emancipation will mean the emancipation of the whole of society. These seem to me to be conclusions and strategic choices that are not particularly Greek, although, as I said, Greece is perhaps a little ahead in temporal terms, but these are strategic choices that the whole of the left in the South and the Balkans can do well with. So only this combination of hegemonic politics with radical intent and social mobilization and conflict can succeed. This is, for me, the task for the left, the task of developing what the idea of communism means for an age of capitalist crisis. Talking, of course, about specifically Greece, it is a very tall order for a small country and an even smaller organization. It can succeed only if the European movements learn from that Greek experience and follow similar strategies. In such a case, the Greece of resistance will become the future of Europe. In 1821, the great romantic poet Percy Shelley, published his famous lyrical drama, as he called it, Hellas. When he learned of the Greek Revolution against the Ottoman Empire, the beginning of 1821, he collected information and then, in November of the same year, published the poem Hellas as an attempt to inform the English and European public and support the revolution. The last words of the preface to Hellas are, "We're all Greeks," a slogan that had been adopted by various philanthropists and do-gooders around the world who asked people in the same way they were asking in Band Aid and all these other great telethons to help the starving people in Africa now to give money to go to the Greeks. Shelley had nothing like that in mind. Shelley had in mind Greece, or the Greeks, the Greek Revolution at that time, as the incorporation, the incarnation of the principle of freedom that he saw developing in Paris, in Bastille, in the Revolution of Haiti, then in Greece, the incarnation of the spirit of freedom in Western history. The poem finishes as follows: "Let freedom live wherever she flies. A desert or a paradise. Let the beautiful and the brave share her glory or a grave. This is the dilemma in front of Greece and in front of the rest of Europe, certainly of the Balkans and Southern Europe. Are we going to move to a desert or a paradise? These are the two alternatives. Continuing with the catastrophic neoliberal biopolitical capitalism that is destroying lives and families and ethos and, of course, economies, or join that resistance that will reintroduce the spirit of freedom into our history. Thank you.
Ja bih zahvalio profesoru Douzinasu i upravo između Mick Jaggera i Keith Richardsa ja sam uvijek izabirao Lou Reeda ili Iggy Popa, pa tako i u ovom slučaju. Tako da nikad nisam volio ovaj Stonesep, više sam preferirao Stooges, pa još jedan put puno hvala, jer ovo je bilo stvarno dobro. Ajmo ovo pozdraviti jednim lijepim aplauzom. Imat ćemo nekoliko minuta za pitanja. Molim vas, budite precizni i jasni. Pitanja mogu biti kratka. Upravo su nas obavijestili da ćemo morati završiti puno prije, jer moramo isprazniti dvoranu, zato jer dolaze Mick Jagger i Keith Richards. Ok, izvolite sa vašim pitanjima. Možete postaviti na hrvatskom ili na engleskom. Imamo ove prevoditelje i tako.
Thank you. I don't know if I will be lucky enough to flow along the language speaking instead of myself, or a stranger in me speaking instead of myself, but let's try. I would like to refer to this initial part of the lecture, to the project of analytics of resistance, which I find personally very interesting and very stimulating also in terms of my own work. And I would like to ask about certain more precise philosophical backgrounds of this kind of tracing of the resistance as a kind of a basic and maybe stable feature of, I don't know, human constitution or something as such. Because apart from this nice reference to very primordial gestures of Judaic and Greek tradition, I would like to ask if there is a kind of more coherent philosophical background in it. I mean here, for example, the question if this kind of resistance as kind of very basic and primordial move in human is more connected with this kind of impulse of, say, irreducible individuality, which somehow resists being subsumed to more general things, so this kind of singularity and primordial individuality, which is precisely not totalizable. Or is it more a kind of impulse which is precisely connected with already being with others in terms of being with, in terms of being clicked with lacks and being all the time somehow projected or entangled in being precisely not as a kind of entity enclosed into itself?
Thank you very much. Of course, this is a question that requires you know, 5 or 10 minutes, or you know, a couple of hours of answer, but a whole book. And indeed, there is a book that answers it. But what I can say very briefly is that, of course, initially I mentioned Foucault, Michel Foucault, and the analytics of power, from which, you know, I take my starting position. But of course, then the situation becomes much more complicated and complex, as you mentioned. In a sense, we refer both to the Hegelian tradition, but also the post-Hegelian and post-psychoanalytic tradition of people like, I saw in your question, everyone from perhaps Derrida to Jean-Luc Nancy, the idea of uniqueness. I would want, however, at this point, you know, before getting into a kind of heavy philosophical exegesis, to say that I don't think, or certainly my view, that this idea of disobedience and resistance, which of course is not always necessarily positive, you know, it needs always an axiological and normative judgment as to whether it's good or bad. So, you know, as I said, it is a fact, not an obligation. It is something that happens in life almost automatically, almost necessarily, and not, you know, sort of the result
of ideas and so on. Now, the only way that I could conclude this very, I suppose, general statement a minute, is that in my mind it has nothing to do certainly with individualism, which is very much a modern development, not just with community and being with others, which of course in a strong, thick way would take us to pre-modern communities, or in that Nancyan way would take us to the uniqueness of the individual. I would put it in more simple and perhaps psychoanalytical terms. The idea of being is always related to law. There is law, there is command to which we always respond. There is a law and there is a law of law. And to the extent that my relationship to law, which is absolutely constitutive of my very existence, it is a relationship which is always open to obedience and disobedience. Because law creates life, because the subjectivity is always related to a certain legality, resisting and obeying are absolutely constitutive from the very first point, and not only in particular relations of either community or individuality or uniqueness, ontological uniqueness.
Thank you very much, Professor Costas.
Thanks for the lecture. While I found your analysis tremendously important and interesting, I really have a strong need to say that in it is so much Eurocentrism, because you are focusing only on the European examples. For example, with the analysis of the situations, you are claiming that Greece was chosen as a guinea pig for resolving the crisis of capitalism. Well, that may be true for Europe. We have 140 developing countries, and majority of them went from the structural adjustment programs, the same ones that are happening now in Greece, just to mention, I don't know, countries in Africa or the countries in Latin America. Then you were discussing resistance, the new way of resisting the situations, while the ways that people in Greece are resisting are nothing new. They happened in Latin America in the 2000s with the Cochabamba water wars, and in 2002 with El Alto occupation, where the city was occupied for more than 2 months, and now it is self-organized, and people there are self-organizing their lives. So basically, this Eurocentrism is really blocking our way of thinking, blocking our way of resisting, and blocking our way of political acts. So really interesting thing is that you came to the same conclusions as the theoreticians of the movements of Latin America. So basically, in that there is an interesting, I don't know how to put it, philosophical truth or something like that, that you and the people in the Latin America came to the same conclusions and the same ideas, and the way that you were describing what the role of the left is, that happened in Bolivia, that they joined together the politics of conflict, developed those that were the most repressed, so the Indians, and they put it together with the hegemonic positions of the new president, now Morales. So I really think that we should also focus on other countries, not only on European Union.
Thank you very much, and I do accept your criticism. I mean, obviously, I have been informed about what is happening in Latin America. Indeed, I spend perhaps 2 or 3 months every year in Brazil, in Colombia, and occasionally in Bolivia. So, but the point you're making is a valid point. Perhaps I am Eurocentric. But in a sense, what I'm arguing here is, first of all, that the Greek case has characteristics of those types of resistance all over the world. And perhaps you are right, they start in Latin America. But as I'm putting together a theoretical, or if I want to be grandiose, a philosophical position, whether I use the example of Greece, Venezuela, or Bolivia is of secondary importance. I'm not going to, obviously, abandon the interest in a particular place in Europe or whatever because it happened elsewhere. If there are convergences, that, as you said very kindly, might help understand the wider applicability of the philosophical position. But the philosophical position does not depend necessarily or always upon its place of emergence. Truth in a sense, is not localized. Resistances are, as I said, and because resistances are, in order to come to a conclusion about the philosophical, as it were, undergirding of a particular type of activity or different types of resistance, you have to start from a specific situation. I could have started in Venezuela. Unfortunately, I was born in Greece and I live in England.
Thank you, Costas. Building a little bit on the prior question, I'd like to ask about whether Greece does represent such a relatively optimistic picture through the lens of the drachma versus euro debate, not as an economic debate, but as a political one. I work with civil society internationally. I work on the IMF. I coordinate, I advocate, I seek to understand. I'm talking about countries, as was referenced in the earlier question, sub-Saharan Africa and the Caribbean and troika states in North Africa. And there's a dilemma that does seem to be common, and that is to do with, do we, and so I want to sort of focus in on your points about praxis, essentially about, you know, what is the radical intent and how do we identify those fault lines? And I would say that there is one that seems to be common and commonly discussed and is currently very hotly debated. And that in Greece is, I could say, was represented by this debate in drachma versus euro terms. And that dilemma is whether we seek debt forgiveness, and I think it's a very interesting term, which is essentially another way of saying negotiating, or do we seek repudiation, which is almost the opposite of redemption. And it's interesting how these terms have double meanings in English. Because, you know, as bankers often say, if I lend you $100 and you can't pay me back, then that's your problem. But if I lend you $100 million and you can't pay me back, then that's my problem. And I think that if we take such an optimistic view of what's happening in Greece, I would raise the question of whether the Greek left, in its problematic grappling with the question of re-drachmatization or whether the euro and its treatment as a essentially economic question rather than a question of resistance and a political debate gets to the heart of this, and whether therefore we can have such a optimistic view of the sort of dynamics you've described.
Yes, now this is a harder question at a number of levels. First, I would say that my attempt over the last 3 years, having had the great honor and opportunity of writing for the British newspaper, The Guardian, has been almost consistently an attempt precisely to offer a more optimistic view of the crisis in Southern Europe and specifically in Greece. The reporting of Greece and Greeks as cheating, liars, lazy, people who do not deserve, you know, the slightest either compassion or solidarity from the rest of the European Union was an image that I set out to confront. Not necessarily because I did not believe in some of the positions of the opposite side, but because I believe that once you're given the chance, whoever has the chance to participate in public debate, and to that extent, even so little, to push the wider view about the problem, any problem, in a specific direction, one should take that, even if you're not absolutely convinced for it. So for me, my intervention, my writings, and even my talk today is part of an attempt to influence a situation rather than to describe it. I'm not an economist. I think that the economics debate has been banal and boring, repetitive in large terms, and has given the impression that economics is the only way that decides our life. As far as I'm concerned, this is a totally wrong way of understanding the world. This is a way that reproduces now in neoliberal forms a certain Marxism, reductionism, and economism, and I want to resist it as far as I can. Now, on the wider questions you pose in relation to issues about debt redemption or debt restructuring and so on, I mean, these are the kinds of things that you very rightly posit, But of course, these are the things that are being discussed every day in every bloody newspaper, news broadcast, and every public debate, as I'm sure, you know, sort of, it will happen again later today. And this is what, first of all, I don't feel that I'm particularly competent to say much, although I'm a well-informed individual. But secondly, because I believe in more drastic and central and crucial terms, that an economics debate without those cultural, political, and social aspects leads to pretty much a cul-de-sac, an impasse. So it is an attempt to try and slightly redirect debate. Secondly, to set those optimistic views out to people that have never heard anything good about what is happening in Southern Europe or in the Balkans. And that seems to me to be a political task.
Hello, Professor Douzinas, and thank you for this ray of hope you provided. So coming from Bosnia, I always tend to talk from our personal example, and I want to go along the question of the fault lines you mentioned. So in Bosnia, the intelligentsia, well, most of the youth intelligentsia considers one of these fault lines to be the entrance of Bosnia into the European Union, that privatization should be viewed as a positive thing, that it will provide more and more opportunities for everyone in a rotten system already to have better healthcare and better education. So what do we do with these people who consider these fault lines as the things we're fighting for?
In the fault line in that analysis of hegemonic policies, post-Gramscian hegemonic policies, is something that you choose. In other words, you see what are the possibilities that exist in a particular society, and you choose the one that appears to have the greatest ability to bring together all these different conflicting groups, sectors of society in a wider project of emancipation, in a wider project of left unity. Now, if, as you're saying, in Bosnia specifically, the European Union appears to be one of these things that could unite people, but at this point in time, the European Union appears to be in a process of disintegration and decay. It appears to be acting precisely against the interests of the people generally, and certainly the interests of an emancipated and equal society, then of course, not only you do not choose that as a fault line, you actively campaign against it. So it is a political choice. It is a strategic choice. You have to find in each particular point in time what type of policy and strategy is generally consistent with your own political line of emancipation and equality and social justice, while, of course, at the same time, it is never just that. It would be less than that in order to be able to create the widest possible way, the widest possible popular poll.
Thank you very much, Professor Douzinas. Once again, let's clap. Još jedanput hvala vam svima što ste došli i evo možemo sada polako se pripremati za sljedeći session. Puno hvala Bog.